Okay, so in our lecture on numerical methods, we are in the discussion on the Monte Carlo method. And inside this discussion, we looked at Monte Carlo integration. And for this, we need uniform random numbers. So we looked at uniform random number generation. And a nice result, which we derived in the last section, was the Coxma-Lafka inequality, which showed us that the approximation error, so the difference between our Monte Carlo integral, so just the sum of the function evaluation at the given sequence divided by the number of sample points, and the true integral can be estimated by the product of two parts, the variation of the function, so how much does the function change on this domain, multiplied with the so-called discrepancy of the sequence. So do we find large empty spaces, or do we find large clusters or clusters on small spaces in the sequence? And this motivated, so since we maybe cannot change the properties of the function which we like to integrate, so this motivated our need for low discrepancy sequences. So sequences with low discrepancy. And this is the topic which we like to do today. So I already gave you one coding example of a sequence which in one dimension has a nice low discrepancy. So if you just take the equidistribution of your sample points, so xi is just I divided by n, then this sequence has a discrepancy of 1 divided by n and is, say, in our application optimal, yeah, so without further knowledge of the function f. So however, this sequence has an issue. Whenever we like to increase the number n, so here in this sequence, so if we like to increase, and we need to generate a new sequence, yeah, because the whole sequence, every point depends on this n. And this is not what we like. So we like to retain the nice property of a Monte Carlo integration that we can add more points to increase the accuracy. So what we like is instead, we like to have some kind of infinite sequence. So an algorithm which generates points, more and more points. So we like to have an infinite sequence. So xi, such that for every k, the subsequence from say x1 to xk is low, yeah, is small. So we have low discrepancy for every finite subsequence of this infinite sequence. So maybe I have a little bit more space here. Okay, or maybe I write it on the next page. So the idea of the So the idea of the log discrepancy sequence is to have some algorithm that generates new points again one after the other, such that the sequence in between retains this property of low discrepancy as good as possible. So, and I, maybe I draw this a little bit nicer. So we already looked at this. Yesterday at the end of the session. So assume we would like to have a sequence in one dimension for this interval. So where would we place maybe the first point? Okay, maybe just in the middle, 1/2. So the first point is 1/2. Then we like to refine. Yeah. Now we have two intervals that are of size 1/2. The refinement which we think of is maybe to cut them in two parts. Yeah. So that would be 1/4. So we place a point here. Okay, still the discrepancy is not improved because there's a large open space on the right-hand side. So the next point here is 1/4. Okay, so then the next point is which we place is improving the discrepancy because we split this interval here. So the next point is 3/4. Okay, so 3/4, let's place this here. 3/4. So actually 3/4 is one half plus 1/4. So we go to the next point based on this first point. Okay, so the next refinement which we would like to do is again split an interval into half. Yeah, so the next refinement would be 1/8. So let's use 1/8 here. Okay, so 1/8. So if you like to have it split nicely, maybe the next point should not be too close to this last point, the 1/8. So, but maybe it should also not be too far away. Yeah? So maybe a natural thing would be to place the next point in this interval, yeah, which is actually 5/8. Which is 1/2 plus 1/8. So this is 1/2 plus 1/8. Okay. So where should we place the next point? If we like to have some kind of algorithm, maybe now it's a little bit clear, yeah, from the second line which I'm writing. So what we could do, yeah, so you have your refinement 1/8. So maybe in the next point is 1/4 plus 1/8. So this is 3/8. Which is our previous point 1/4 plus 1/8. Okay, so where's maybe the next point? So now we have refined on the left-hand side. So the next point should maybe be, so you see that I actually refine, take my refinement, and then I add my refinement on the previous point. So you see, I add my 1/8 to 1/2 and to 1/4. The next thing would be to add it to 3/4, which was this point here. So the next one should go here, which is the 3/4 plus the 1/8. So the 3/4 plus my refinement 1/8. Okay, so visually it's maybe clear what we do. Yeah, so this is 7/8. The black one is 7/8. Okay, and then we have finished the refinement block of 1/8. So this is the refinement block for new points, each point with a distance of 1/8 to the next point. Yeah. So the first 1/8 is just the distance from 0. And then we have 3 points, 5/8, 3/8, 7/8, which are actually added to the refinement block corresponding to 1/4 and the initial point 1/2. Oops, sorry. So that one was 1/2 and that one was 1/4. Okay, so now while talking here, we constructed maybe some kind of very simple algorithm to refine the intervals just by splitting them into 1/2. Just using the new refinement and adding it to the whole sequence we have so far, including the 0. Yeah? So you can think of some, say, 0 being invisible here in front of this sequence. Yeah? And that's now our sequence. Okay, so maybe the 0 does not belong to the sequence, it's just imaginary, but you add it to the refinement to the sequence. Okay, so this sequence has a name. Yeah, it's called the van der Korput sequence, and it's the first nice example for a low discrepancy sequence, because it has the property that we add more and more points. And actually, you see, this goes in powers of 2. Yeah, so the first level of refinement 1/2 is 2^0. The next level of refinement 1/4 adds 2 points, which is 2^1. Yeah, 2. The next level of refinement, 1/8, adds 4 points, which is 2^2. Yeah, so whenever we have a 2^ k, and whenever the k is increasing, we have completed the refinement. So at those points, we have actually the equidistributed sequence, which has a low discrepancy. In between, our discrepancy is actually not improving. Yeah? But whenever we double the number of points, we have improved the discrepancy. And the way we add the points in between is also quite nice, because we never add many points in the same region. Yeah. So, okay. So While so from this explanation, the algorithm looks quite simple, you maybe think that the algorithm is takes long or is complicated to construct, but actually this is not the case. Yeah. So if you look at the second line below my numbers, yeah, so you see this is here, the first one is 1 × 1/2. The next number is 1 × 1/4. And 0 × 1/2, so 1, 0. The next one is 1 × 1/2 plus 1 × 1/4. So it's a little bit like 1, 1. The next one is 1 × 1/8 plus 0 × 1/4 plus 0 × 1/2, yeah, 1/2. So it's a little bit like 1, 0, 0. The next one is 1 × 1/8, 0 × 1/4, plus 1 × 1/2. Yeah? So I'm talking about this one here. Yeah? It's 1/8 plus 0 × 1/4 plus 1/2. Okay. So this is a little bit like 1, 0, 1. Okay, so the next one is 1 × 1/8 plus 1 × 1/4 plus 0 × 1/2. It's a little bit like 1, 1, 0. So you see actually that the terms here are a little bit like a binary sequence. Whoops, a binary sequence. So this here is like a binary sequence, which is a coefficient, which can be, say, 0 or 1. So a coefficient which can be 0 or 1. So, and then it is a coefficient in front of 1/2. A coefficient in front of 1/4, and so on. And these coefficients, which are either 0 or 1, are a little bit like the binaries. Actually, the binaries corresponding to the index. Okay, so we can write this down. So this is the van der Korput sequence. So a simple example for a one-dimensional low discrepancy sequence is the van der Korput sequence. It can be generalized to different refinements. You can also do it with 1/3 instead of 1/2. Yeah, having always cutting the intervals into 3 intervals instead of 2 intervals. So this is this number b. So let b be in n b larger than 1. So a natural number which is the base of this sequence, and then we can construct the sequence xi in the set of uniform numbers the following way. So xi is an infinite sum with some coefficient aij multiplied with b to the power of minus j. So if b is 2, yeah, this is 1 divided by b by 2, 1 divided by 2 to the power of j. So it's actually 1/2, 1/4, 1/8. Okay. So this guy here, the b to the power of minus j, this is our 1/2, 1/4, 1/8. Okay. So, and now how do we get the coefficients? The coefficients aij are coefficients in the set from 0 to b minus 1. So if the base b is 2, it is 0 or 1. Otherwise, if we have 3 intervals, so the base is 3, it is 0, 1, 2. Yeah? And the coefficients are given by representing the index So representing the index in terms of the coefficients multiplied with the base to the power of j minus 1. Okay. So I will give you an example in a few seconds, but first, this is an infinite sum. Yeah. But actually, it is finite because aij will be zero for j large enough. Yeah. Okay, so let's write an example to make it maybe a little bit clear. Yeah. Example, let's take the base b equals 2. Okay, and we take the index I equal, say, we take 7. Let's take 7. So then the binary representation of 7 is one times one, now let's take 5, because otherwise it's maybe nicer. Let's take 5. So then we get an example which was in the previous slide. So it's 1 times 1, yeah, plus 0 times 2. Yeah. The 1 is here the b to the power of 0. This is the b to the power of 1. And it is 1 times 4, which is the b to the power of 2. Okay, so this 1 here is my aij, my ai 1. So you see there is a small index shift. J runs from 1, but I take b to the power of j minus 1. So this here is my, this 0 here is my a I 2. And this here is my a I 3. Okay. And all the other coefficients, a I 4, a I 5, are 0. Yeah? So actually it's a finite sum. So then we have that x5 so now we take these coefficients is 1 times b to the power of minus j 1 times 1 over 8 plus 0 times 1 over 4 plus 1 times 1 over 2. Yeah. So where actually these numbers here correspond. Yeah. So this one here is the AI 1, which is here in front. This now, this 0 here is the AI 2 in front of this fraction. And now this, say this one here is the one in front of here, and we get as a result 1/2 plus 1 over 8, so 5 over 8, which is our x5. So, which is here our x5 in the sequence. Yeah, the 5 over 8, the fifth element in our sequence, 1/2, 1 over 4, 3 over 4, 1 over 8, 5 over 8. So this is now a mathematical representation of the sequence. So we have to get the coefficients. Yeah, the coefficients are just the binary representation of the index. If we have base 2 binary, yeah. Otherwise, it's the base B representation of the index. And then we just calculate this this sum of fractions. Okay, so maybe we implement this. Okay, before I implement this, I would maybe continue a little bit with the discussion. Yeah, we have some code. So here on this slide, yeah, you find the first four elements, yeah, constructed as I told you on the left hand side, the representation of the index, on the right hand side, the corresponding element in the sequence, yeah, and you see that the coefficients corresponds, yeah, so 0, 0, 1 in the last line gives you 0, 0, 1 in front of the fractions, and below I also mentioned here the van der Korput sequence, for example, for base 10, yeah, for base 10. So then you of course you start by first by having a distribution, everything has interval length 1/10, and then you start refining this this sequence. Okay, and then it becomes finer and finer. Okay, so now you can prove that the star discrepancy of this sequence is log n over n. So the point is that in between, your discrepancy maybe does not improve. Yeah? But if you now go back to the Coxma-Lafka inequality, which we had here, so you see our error estimate is the variation of the function multiplied with the star discrepancy. So with this sequence, we would get a convergence rate which is better than that of our Monte Carlo approximation using a sampling of IID random variables. So note, this is better than pseudo random number generators, from which we get a 1 divided by square root of n. Okay, so we have an infinite sequence, so we can improve the accuracy by just adding more points. Actually, I will discuss if it is really better or not at the end of this session. Yeah, you have to be a little bit careful. It looks better for a mathematician, but in practice, it's maybe not not better. So now let's start implement maybe this this algorithm. So let's have a small first coding session. Okay, so here we have a package random numbers. So maybe here I add a new class which I call van der Korput sequence. Okay. And well, this sequence has a base, yeah. So let's, we could add a member base, but before I add the member base, just add maybe a static method, yeah. Okay, so let's have a static method which calculates this get van der Korput. number for a given index. So the index can be an integer or a long and a given base. So I would like to calculate xi for a given I. The index is here the I and a given base. So if we add some documentation here, the index of the sequence. So actually in computers, we often start in zero. So starting with zero, the base, okay. The van der Korput number. Okay, so in computers, we often start with zero, but if you go back to the definition, the index j, the index I here started by in one. So I started in one. X1 is the first point. X1 corresponds to 1 × 1/2. So 1/2 is the first point. So the first point of the sequence is 1/2. So let's add 1 to this number index here. Okay, so this number index is now starting in 1, so the user will request it with 0. And now let's calculate the x corresponding to this index. So I need some x. Okay, so maybe what else do we need? So the refinement is always done with 1 divided by base. So if the base is 2, I always refine with 1 divided by 2, so 1/2. So let's have this refinement factor defined here. So it's 1.0 divided by the base. Okay. So, and what's the first thing which we add? So, actually we check, if you look at the binary representation, 1, 2 is 1, 0, 3 is 1, 1. So the last bit of the number is actually indicating if the number is divisible by 2 or not. Okay, so what we will do is we take the index divided by the base. And from this division, we take the remainder. So index divided by base for 1 divided by 2, the remainder is 1. For 2 divided by 2, it's 0. For 3 divided by 2, the remainder is 1. So this alternates. Okay. So, and if the last bit is set, we would like to add our refinement factor 1/2. So this is multiplied with the refinement factor. This would like, we would like to add to x. Okay. So now we repeat this. Because now we divide the index by 2. So we shift all the bits from the index to the right. So we divide index equals index divided by the base. Okay, the last bit is gone. Okay, and now our refinement factor becomes finer. So we go from 1/2 to 1/4. So the refinement factor is becoming smaller. So it's now 1/4. Then we check if the remaining index is divisible by the base, which means does he have a 1 in the next position? Does he have a 1 in the next position? If yes, we add this number multiplied with the refinement factor. So then again, we divide by 2. So we shift all the bits and check, is this guy here divisible by 2? So is this bit set? If yes, we add the next refining factor. So we just repeat this until the index is 0, okay? So what's wrong here? Oh, one space too much here. Okay, so actually this should be the algorithm. So I hope you you could follow this. If not, feel free to ask question in the chat. So let's return the number, return X. Okay, so let's go through the algorithm again. Yeah, maybe with an example. Yeah. Index is 4. So when we call the function, so we would like to have x4, but the sequence in our implementation starts in 0, because in the computer we often like to start sequences in 0. So this means for our sequence here, we would actually like to have x5. Yeah, so we would like to have here the I equals 5, the guy which is here. So this is exactly this example we had here. So we enter here with a 4, but we calculate in the mathematical formula the index I equals 5. Yeah? So convert the 4 to a 5. So we calculate with base 2, our refinement vector is 1/2. So this guy is 1/2 here. So our index is larger than 0. Divide the index by 2. Yeah? So 5 divided by 2 is 2, remainder 1. And get the remainder. This is the remainder. So this is 1. Our refinement factor is 1/2. So 1 times 1/2. Okay, so this is added to our number. So this is here the first 1/2. So then divide the index by 2. So it was 5 before, divided by 2, where the remainder is thrown away. It's an integer division. So the index is then 2. Yeah, the next index is 2. The refinement factor is 1/2. Okay, the index is still greater than 0. Now our index is 2. Yeah? So 2 divided by 2 has remainder 0. Yeah? So this is 0 multiplied with the new refinement factor 1 over 4. So this corresponds to 0 multiplied with 1 over 4. Okay, so then the index is divided by 2. 2 divided by 2 gives 1. Okay, the refinement factor is refined. 1 over 8 divided by 2 gives 1 over 4 divided by 2 gives 1 over 8. So it's refined, 1 over 8. The index is now 1. It's still larger than 0. 1 divided by 2 is 0, remainder 1. So this remainder here is 1. 1 times 1 over 8 is this 1 over 8. Okay, so you see, this is a quite simple algorithm, yeah, for this sequence. And maybe we can add some small main program here to print this. Let's print the first 10 elements. Oh, I hope I did everything right here, yeah. Live coding is sometimes not easy. Yeah, so double X is the van der Korput number for this index and base 2. Okay, we used long, but he can cast it. And let's print this. Oops. Let's print I and X in a small table. Okay, so these are the first numbers generated, 1/2, 1/4, yeah? Then 1/2 plus 1/4, then it goes to 1/8. So then it is this 1/2 plus the 1/8, then it is this 1/4 plus the 1/8, it's this number and that number. Then it goes to the next refinement level, yeah? So it's 1/16. And this is 1/8. So that was 1/4. So sorry, it's still 1/8. Yeah. So that's 1/8. That this is 1/2 plus 1/8. This is 1/4 plus 1/8. So maybe we print a few more numbers, yeah, so we can go to the next level with 1/16. Okay, so this is the refinement level, 1/8. Okay, oops. Of course, I have to go to 24. So here is the next refinement level. Okay. We have a low discrepancy sequence. So what's next? Yes. How about continuing our programming session and use this for Monte Carlo integration? Yeah. So we already had a Monte Carlo integration experiment. So with this equidistributed sequence, so let's have a new experiment here. Monte Carlo integration experiment with quasi random numbers. Let's have a main method here. And maybe I do an example which we had before. So the function which I like to integrate is just x to the power of 3. Okay. So because for this function, sorry, that's an equal sign. For this function, we know the analytic value. Integrating it from 0 to 1 gives 1/4. So, and then we can maybe calculate Monte Carlo integrals. Yeah? So we have some integer number of sample points. Let's take maybe 10,000. Okay, and we calculate now the Monte Carlo sum. So double sum, and now we call the sum with the van der Korput sequence. We calculate this. So we need a van der Korput sequence. Let's initialize this here. So now we have a class which does this van der Korput sequence. Oh, actually I did a static method. So actually I need to initialize an object. Okay. So let's do it without. So for integer I from 0 to number of sample points, we like to calculate the sum of the function evaluation. So this is my x, or let's say sum is plus f of xi. So it is a function evaluated at the xi. So what is the xi? It's the van der Korput sequence at I for the given base 2. So then our Monte Carlo integral for this sequence is the sum divided by the total number of sample points. Okay, and then I can print this, or let's also calculate the error. It's the integral van der Corput minus the integral analytic. So let's print this now. So this is we get this integral and we get this error here. Some typos have to be fixed. So let's try this this program. Okay, 10 to the minus 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, looks like order 1 divided by n. Yeah? Looks like what we had here on the slide, that the convergence rate is 1 divided by n. Yeah? So log n divided by n, yeah, it's not exactly 10 to the minus 4. And also there is in the Cox-Malafka, the variation of the function in front. Now I would like to compare this with the other integration methods. So let's also try a Monte Carlo integration with Mersenne-Twister, so a pseudo number random number generator. So we have Mersenne-Twister here. We initialize it with some seed, just some initialization of the sequence. So we use also the Mersenne-Twister. So the sum of Mersenne-Twister is also just the function evaluated at the next random number. So at next double. So what is this? Get, so next double. Okay. So, so we can also calculate the integral of Mersenne-Twister. So I just copy this here and say that the integral of Mersenne-Twister and I have the error of the Mersenne-Twister and I like to print this. Print this out. Okay, so this is a pseudo random number generator, and I would like to print this for the Mersenne-Twister. Okay, so let's run the program. Okay, 10 to the minus 4, also good. Yeah, so but maybe we can add a few more points here. Pseudo random number generator has become bad, yeah? Because it is a Monte Carlo. It is in probability, yeah. So it's wiggling around, and sometimes we are good or better by luck. So the 10 to the minus 4 you saw previously was just luck. Okay, so let's add more numbers. 10 to the minus 4, 5, but the other one, or 10 to the minus 4, it's actually, but the other one is at 2 times 10 to the minus 6. I would like to add 1/3 variation. That is the equidistributed sequence. Yeah. So So we had the sequence I divided by n. Yeah. So you remember from my intro of today's session, I divided by n had also discrepancy 1 divided by n. So very nice discrepancy. So this is just the function evaluated at, and now what's the x? The x is I as a floating point number divided by number of sample points. Okay, I divided by n. Okay, and we can take a look at this. So let's have again the same integration. So we have the sum of equidistributed numbers divided by the sample points gives me now the integral for equidistributed. So let's maybe use distributed here. And I calculate the error of this by the difference of this integral equidistributed from the integral analytic. Okay, and we also like to print this. Okay, so let's print this and the error. Okay, and so let's run this program. Okay, and we get a 10 to the minus 7. Yeah, actually, it's 1/2 10 to the minus 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah, it's actually 1/2 times 1 divided by n. Okay, so the 1/2 comes from the fact that the variation of the function is not in all regions the same, so it's some region is a bit smaller, we get higher accuracy. Okay, so you see that equidistributed is actually the best. Yeah, the van der Korput sequence is also very good, and the pseudo random number generator is the worst. Now I'd like to make a small modification. Yeah, let's calculate this integral and the error inside the loop, just using the current number of sample points. So I plus one here. Yeah. So I starts from zero, yeah, but zero is the first sample point. So I plus one is the number of sample points which we have used so far. Okay. Okay, so I use now a loop and I calculate the integral, how it improves. Yeah? So the final value is then the final value which we get. And then I would like to plot or to say print. Yeah. So maybe you can also have a nice plot. The error of the three. So first let's print the error of the Mersenne. So let's create a small table, then print the error of the equidistributed sequence, and then print the error of the van der Korput sequence. Okay, so let's print this. So run the program. Okay, so maybe now it prints a lot of stuff. Yeah. Maybe I also like to see the index in front. So I like to see the number of sample points we used in front. And maybe I do not like to print this for every, say, index. Maybe I print every 100 indices a line, yeah. So I do not get too much output. So, yeah, you see, I print only every 100 integration steps. I print this. Okay, and here maybe I add here a few more spaces to table to get it right. Now this looks ugly. What's wrong? Ah, okay. This is there was a slash backslash missing. Okay. So now the table is nice. Okay, so you see we do 100,000, no, actually 1,000,000, huh? 1,000,000 sample points, yeah. Okay, and you see how the integral converges or improves, yeah. So maybe I take a few less, yeah, just 100,000. That's maybe also enough to already see it. So what do we actually see? So this here is a 10 to the minus 3. This is a 2 times 10 to the minus 5. This is a 10 to the minus 6. So the 10 to the minus 3 is the square root of the 10 to the minus 6. So actually this here is what we would expect from Monte Carlo, a 10 to the minus 3. This here is what we expect from the equidistributed sequence. It's 1 over n, 10 to the minus 6. Actually, it's 1 half, 10 to the minus 5. Yeah. And this here is almost as good. Yeah, but you see this here is only good at the last point, because only then we fill the whole domain. A little bit before, we are already worse than the van der Kolk sequence. And actually even here, yeah, a little bit before, we do not match Monte Carlo. This is because we are integrating the interval from 0 to 1. Yeah, and actually the function x to the power of 3 has a lot of stuff going on the last interval. So here we miss the last interval if we do equidistribution and just have no points in this right space. Okay, so then if you go further up, yeah, you see that the sequences actually have convergence. Yeah, so it becomes, the error becomes larger, yeah, for smaller numbers. And you also see the effect which we had before. We have a Monte Carlo simulation, so sometimes it can be that Monte Carlo is much better, yeah, than here, for example, the van der Kolk sequence. Yeah. But then the van der Kolk sequence overtakes again. But here, for example, by chance, we were much better. Yeah. So you also see the randomness in this sequence. Yeah. So sometimes here you are much better, but this one takes over. And of course, the equidistributed is not not usable, because we need to simulate, so it's not usable as an infinite sequence. Okay, so let's continue with the script. Yeah, so we discussed the van der Kolk sequence. The next thing I would like to do is to generalize this to higher dimensions. Okay, so before I do this, so now before we look at higher dimensional discrepancy sequences, I would like to recall that in an earlier session, we had this picture here. So when we like to create, say, a sequence in two dimensions, yeah. So maybe I change here the notation a little bit. So this is now, say, y1. Whoops. This is y1. This is y2. Then we had the thing that I create ij, or actually maybe I use now kj. So the case element of the j's element, the case component of the j's element of the d-dimensional sequence, yeah, is given by picking in the one-dimensional sequence X the element k times d plus j. And actually, to have this notation, this should be starting at zero. Let's take this k zero, y zero, and y one. Yeah, so like in the computer. So we can construct a sequence of sample vectors from a one-dimensional sequence by just populating the components. And we also had some code for this. I had here this random vector, which actually does this. So you see here is the random number generator, and we generate a d-dimensional sequence. So actually this is now my kj. Yeah? So actually here it's jk, yeah, because the first element of this double array is the element in the sequence, and the second element, second bracket, is the index of the dimension. And I'm just populating the random sequence ij here by looping inside over all dimensions, and then I step to the next element of this sequence. Okay, and I also had this small code here to plot this. So from the sequence, from the two-dimensional sequence, I ask, give me just the sequence of the first component. So I'm cutting through the first component, and give me the sequence of the second component. And from this x and y, do some scatter plot. And if we run this, we had this little picture of the scatter plot. Okay, so now I would like to do the same with the van der Korput sequence. So let's have this random vector here generated from the van der Korput sequence. So I duplicate just my code here. I call this random vector quasi, yeah, since van der Korput is a quasi random number sequence. And I call it wrong because actually I will do something wrong now. Okay, so my random vector quasi wrong. I would like to have the van der Korput sequence. So let's get rid of this random number generator and create a van der Korput sequence here. So from the van der Korput sequence, I would like to have a sequence with base 2. Okay. And the index is now calculating using this rule here. So it is I times dimension plus j. Okay. So that's now just the same idea, yeah. So just the same idea as we had here on this slide, where x is the van der Korput sequence. And let's plot this. So I need also this little program here. So let's maybe duplicate this code here, call it random vector quasi wrong plot. And in this program here, I use the other random vector. The quasi to get the sequence which I like to plot. So I hope this works now. Let's check what comes out of this. Okay, so we get this picture. Yeah. So compare this picture to that one. Yeah. So that's absolutely not random at all. Yeah? And recall what happens if you have a van der Korput sequence. So we are so So where do I have some space to draw? Here. Or maybe here. So if we have a van der Korput sequence with base 2, then we have 1/2, 1/4, 3/4. Okay, next one is 1/8. Then 1/8 to add it to 1/2. So it's 5/8 and so on. So actually, for example, you see that this sequence has some structure. The second element, say the even one, yeah. If you start counting in indices in one, is always smaller than 1/2, and the odd one is always larger than 1/2. Yeah. So you see larger or equal. So this one always larger or equal than 1/2. This one always smaller, because we just alternate from one side to the other side of while generating this. So if you now use this sequence to generate a vector, it's always that the elements in the first component only cover the right hand side of the area split it by 1/2, and the elements in the second component only the left hand side, so the numbers smaller than 1/2. Yeah? So it's obvious that by doing this alternating from a van der Korput sequence, we do not cover the whole space. Yeah? So we do not get a nice sampling like this. Instead, we get something like this. Yeah? So you see here in this picture, yeah, at the y-axis, this plot is cut off at 0.5. And at the x-axis, this plot is cut off at 0.5. So actually, we are only filling this quadrant, this quarter, and the way we fill it is completely not random. So since this sequence does not be random, we lost this property, and this motivates now the next definition. We need to specify specifically a low discrepancy sequence for higher dimensions. So this is now the Halton sequence. So maybe just complete this remark here. You cannot use a 1D quasi random number generator to generate a higher dimensional sequence as in, say, that was here figure 5, so it was this remark, huh? So as in figure 5, as in figure 5 of the previous session. Okay, so the Halton sequence generalizes now this van der Korput sequence to higher dimensions. And what we do is we generate a van der Korput sequence for every component. But somehow these sequences have to be independent in some way. And the way this independence is created here is by actually having the base being primes. Yeah. So if these are prime numbers, actually you see there's no common factor. So there's no kind of, say, link between the two components. So we have, for every dimension, we have a base. So we have actually a vector of bases. So let B1 to BD be in N, yeah, larger than one, and BJ and BK are co-primes, yeah, so they do not have a common divisor. Yeah. So actually you can achieve this by using prime numbers. Then the sequence in the d-dimensional hypercube, for which every component is a van der Korput sequence with the corresponding base bj. So xij is a van der Korput sequence with the bj. This is called Horton sequence. Okay, so actually now I can create a class Horton sequence. So maybe here we could create a class Horton sequence. Okay, so the Horton sequence, maybe now I store the base in an array. Yeah? So the Horton sequence has an array of bases, which you can initialize. Yeah. So let's generate the constructor. Okay, and then we like to have a method which gives us the Horton number, which is now, this is a d-dimensional vector. Yeah. So get sample point for a given index. Okay, so the sample point for a given index, and this should be just the van der Korput sequence at this index with base I for every I. Yeah? So we have to allocate a vector of for the return value. The length is just the same as the base, yeah, because the length of the base tells me already what's the dimension. I do not need an additional value for this. And then I populate this vector. So for I from 0 to the number of dimensions, the length of this vector, we populate xi is the van der Korput number corresponding to this index with this given base. Okay, that's our Horton sequence. Okay, the Horton sequence is just a van der Korput sequence in every dimension of the vector. And actually here in this constructor, we should actually check that the criteria is met, that the bases do not have a common divisor except one. Yeah, so they are co-primes. Okay, so now we have this Horton sequence, and maybe I can repeat now this plot here, yeah, this generation of our plot. So with the Horton sequence. So maybe I copy this class here, random vector quasi, and now without the word wrong, because now I like to do it right. Yeah. So I like to do it right means we generate a Horton sequence with the corresponding base. Yeah. So maybe I just do dimension 2. Yeah. So if dimension is larger than 2, then actually this should throw an exception. Say illegal argument. Yeah, so currently we only support dimension smaller than 3, or say equal to. Yeah, so maybe we are very lazy. Yeah, so dimension only 2. Okay, I only plotted for dimension 2, but if dimension is 2, let's create here a Halton sequence. Halton sequence with the corresponding basis. Yeah? So which basis do we like to use? Maybe we take base 2 and base 3. Sorry, new integer array with base 2 and base 3. Yeah? So we are in two dimensions. Okay, so now I have the Halton sequence. So now I can ask here the sample point, which is already a vector. Okay, sample point is Halton sequence. Was my method not public? Oh, no. So, sorry. Where is my Halton sequence? Oh, I forgot the public. So, get sample point of this index I. Okay. So, and then we just copy here the xj. Yeah, so the random sequence ij is just the sample point xj. Okay, so, but actually we can just forget about this and just say that our random vector sequence at j is this point. Okay, so now we used the Halton sequence, which is already a two-dimensional sequence, to generate this random vector here. Huh? So, and we have some methods here to get only the sequence for a given component, which is cutting horizontally through this, which I need for the plotting. So now do the plotting. I copy the random quasi vector plot. Random vector plot and rename it to random vector quasi plot. Yeah, so now we have random vector, the random vector plot, random vector quasi, the random vector quasi plot. So we have a little bit of code duplication, but it's just for illustration here. So here we use the random vector quasi with two dimensions to perform the plot. Okay, so, and let's plot this one. This is now the Halton sequence, which base, I hope it works, which base with base 2 and 3. And this looks like this. So now we can compare all the three cases. Yeah? So below you see the van der Korput sequence misused to generate a two-dimensional sequence. This does not work. Above, you see on the right, the pseudo-random number generator, the Mears and Twister, which generates here larger empty spaces and also maybe here, for example, a cluster. Yeah? And on the left side, you see the Halton sequence, which uses for the x-axis base 2. Yeah? So the x-axis is always cut into 1/2, 1/4, and so on. And for the y-axis, we use base 3. Yeah? And you see, it looks like a nice sampling. Yeah, not so many empty spaces as on the right picture. Okay, so now we have a quasi-random number sequence in two dimensions, the Halton sequence. Okay, so here in the script, yeah, for completeness is again the code. Yeah, Halton sequence is just a van der Korput sequence for every component with a different base. So you see the main part here in the code is this idea here of how we calculate the x for a given index and a given base. Also for the Horton sequence, you find articles deriving estimates for the discrepancy, and the star discrepancy of this sequence is log n to the power of d divided by n at most. So we have some kind of upper bound here. There is a constant in front here. This constant C depends on the choice of the basis. Actually, you also find estimates or expressions for these, and it's a little bit like the product of the basis, or B minus one, something like this. And what I like to do to finish this discussion of the discrepancy is actually now compare this to the Monte Carlo case. So a small exercise, compare our estimates, so the convergence estimates for a true IID sequence, so our result which we had only in probability, to the estimate which we get from the Coxmer-Lafka inequality, and say for example a Horton sequence. So let me make this remark here. So let's do this maybe a little bit together. Okay. So in Monte Carlo, estimate with IID uniform distributed. So we had, this holds only in probability, and the estimate was in probability that our Monte Carlo sum deviated from the integral by, okay, there was a sigma, then there was 1 divided by square root of n, and then there was maybe another constant, which was the 1 divided by square root of delta, which was somehow the confidence level for the probability. And for Coxmer-Lafka inequality with the Horton sequence, so there we got actually not in probability, so we get the variation of f. Then we have maybe some constant which depends on the base. Okay. So next thing is the discrepancy. So we have some constant which depends on the base, and we have the log n to the power of d divided by n. Okay, so as a mathematician, or let's print this also in red, as a mathematician, you would say, okay, this is better. So we have the log n to the power of d divided by n. So this converges faster, Yeah, because log n divided by n, yeah, or log n to the power of d divided by n is better than 1 divided by square root of n. At a certain point, this will overtake. So, but look at reasonable numbers. Yeah, for example, n equal 1 million, which is maybe a reasonable number. Yeah, or for example, 1 billion, you have processors that run at gigahertz. Yeah, so a gigahertz means 1 billion cycles per second. So 1 million is maybe a reasonable number if you believe that for each sample point you have maybe 1,000 cycles to do. Yeah, it would already take a few seconds. So actually also in practice, 1 million, 10 million sometimes is used. So for n equals 1 million, we have the square root. Being 1,000, okay. So, what's the logarithm of 1 million? So the natural is 13.8. So for the log of n, yeah. We have something like 13.8, yeah, if you use the natural logarithm. Okay, so, and now the question is, for which d is 13.8 to the power of d larger than 1,000? Okay, so already at dimension 4, yeah, actually the Horton sequence looks not so good. Yeah, depending on maybe what's the constant in front. So for d greater than 3, we are in a similar region. So say depending on the constant c and also our confidence level on the right-hand side. Yeah, so I did not specify these, but you see that if you take some reasonable number for the n, it can be that in high dimensions, it only looks good on the paper, yeah, say for a very large n, and it can be that Monte Carlo with random numbers, uniform generated random numbers, is still maybe the better option. And that's why actually in your problem, you should compare different ways of generating these numbers. Also, maybe one last remark, the function f may have different variation in depending on the components of your sample point. So it can be that actually the function f has larger variation in the first or two or three dimensions than it has in the other dimensions. And then this low discrepancy sequence, which we just created, actually fills the higher dimensions slowly, more slowly than the lower dimensions. It can still be that even in higher dimension, a low discrepancy sequence is better because the low dimensions of the high dimensional space are filled more evenly, are filled better, have a higher convergence rate. So actually the question, which one you should take, depends on not only the dimension and not only the number of points you are able to simulate given the limits of your computer, but also on how high dimensional is actually your function. And so that's maybe the last remark for today, that you should really test your problem and not trust a mathematical convergence rate, which on the paper looks better for the low discrepancy sequences compared to traditional Monte Carlo. And also a last remark on the script, there are other low discrepancy sequences which you might have a look at. I have some references, the Sobol numbers, which have a little bit better properties. A last exercise. Our sequence, the Halton sequence, has a nice property. We can start the sequence at every point where we like. So compare this to the pseudo-random number generators, yeah, like the linear concurrential generator. There we needed the previous point to generate the next point. So actually the algorithm was of the kind that we needed the previous point to generate the next point. We needed to generate the sequence in the order of the sequence. For the Halton sequence, actually we can generate point number 1000 just by using the algorithm. Yeah? So we have some kind of random access for this point. This is a nice property if you like to perform parallelization. And I will do this small experiment in one of the next session where we actually use it to parallelize the algorithm to approximate P. So that's it for the today. So we had some code sessions today. We used our random number generators to generate two-dimensional sequences, one-dimensional sequences, and plotted a little bit the sample vectors. And the approximation of P will be done in a separate session. Here you find some references which you can look at. That's it for today. Thank you.